Good morning to everyone.
Good morning.
On behalf of Soidwar College.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
On behalf of Soidwar. Good morning. In behalf of Soidwar College, it is my pleasure to welcome you all on today's online lecture. This online lecture is a part of the ongoing Science Setu program of DBT Govt of India to celebrate the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. India will mark 75 years of independence on August 15, 2022. In this connection, a series of activities are going on all over the India. Today, our college as a host institution is going to organize such an event with the technical help of National Institute of Immunology, Govt of India. Although the number of students participants are found less due to their ongoing first semester examination. The resource person of today's event is Dr. Sangeeta Bhaskar, scientist, National Institute of Immunology. The topic of today's online lecture is Journey to a Whole Bacteria Candidate Vaccine. Now I am going to give a short introduction of our research person. So I will share it. Okay, today's research person is Dr. Is it visible?
Yes.
Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry.
Yes, it is animation.
Is it visible? No. Okay. Right. About the speaker, Dr. Sangeeta Bhaskar, designation senior scientist, Institute National Institute of Immunology, New Delhi. Qualifications, her qualification, B-Pharm and M-Pharm from Delhi University. She was awarded PhD from JNU. She received gold medal and merit scholarship in all the 4 years of her B-Pharm courses. She received NII award, best work leading to a product. The theme is best work leading to a product. She has been presently working in the field of development immunotherapy for tuberculosis and cancer. Also, her group has been working towards developing a candidate vaccine against tuberculosis. Simultaneously, the group under her guidance are evaluating chemo immunotherapy strategies to combat cancer. Research work is published in peer-reviewed journal. That is all about a short introduction about our research person. Now, I would like to request our respected principal, Dr. A.K. Uja sir, to deliver a welcome address and to inaugurate the event. Thank you.
Respected resource person of today's program, Dr. Sangeeta Bhaskar, Juti Singh, and other dignitaries from DBT and National Institute of Immunology, my colleagues, and student participants. As the great nation is all set for celebrating the 75th anniversary of the independence, I, on behalf of the Soidwar College fraternity, extend warm wishes to you all. In view of realizing Atmanirbhar Bharat by 2022, as envisioned by Honorable Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi, a series of activities under the aegis of various departments have been adopted. As part of this noble initiative, Azadi Ki Amrit Mahotsav is well designed to get underway on the ground of the Science Setu program of Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. It is my earnest hope that the lecture series connected to the Azadi Ki Amrit Mahotsav would be great benefit to the academicians, students, and stakeholders in inculcating a unified, integrated, and composite frame of the nation. We are lucky enough that we are collaborating with National Institute of Immunology, a well-known institution of our nation. And we are lucky enough that today, an eminent scientist, Dr. Sangeeta Bhaskar, senior scientist, National Institute of Immunology, New Delhi, is going to deliver a talk on the title, Journey of a Whole Bacteria Candidate Vaccine. I hope that we would be enriched with various new knowledges from today's talk. With these few words, I declare that the program is being inaugurated. I request Dr. Sangeeta Bhaskar to deliver her speech. Thank you all.
Thank you for your kind introduction and good morning to everyone. I am Dr. Sangeeta Bhaskar from National Institute of Immunology. This is an autonomous institute under Department of Biotechnology, and we conduct both basic as well as applied research over here. And since last many years, my group is working towards development of a immunotherapy for tuberculosis and for cancer. So today I will give a brief glimpse of that research, or I will give a brief overview of the work which is undergoing in my lab. So with these words, I will start my scientific presentation. So I will tell about this journey of this whole bacteria candidate vaccine, which we are developing for tuberculosis as well as for cancer. Before moving ahead, I would like to ask, what are vaccines? These questions I am asking from students. And at the end of my talk also, there will be few questions, and the three students who will give maximum number of right answers, those questions will be from my talk only. Maximum number of right answers, they will get the certificate of appreciation. Three students will get. So this question is, I just want to ask, what are vaccines? Can students interact during the talk also? If not, I will proceed. I think my voice is not.
Yes, you can interact with the students.
Okay.
Ma'am.
Shall I close this? No, I want full screen. No, I have to present. Full screen. So what are vaccines? Vaccination is induction or modulation of an antigen-specific immune response to prevent or cure targeted disease. So there are two words, prevent or cure. Vaccine, one term is that it is antigen-specific immune response. So it is not the non-specific immune response. We say like With vitamin C, we can improve the immunity. Vitamin C is not a vaccine. Vaccine is antigen specific towards that pathogen, or like in case of tumor specific antigen. Vaccines which prevent the targeted disease, they are called prophylactic vaccines, and the vaccines which cure the targeted disease, they are called immunotherapeutic vaccines. So there are two types of vaccines, immunoprophylactic vaccines and immunotherapeutic. Prophylactic, which prevent the disease, and immunotherapeutic, which cure the disease. After the disease is already there, then that immunotherapeutic vaccines are given. And the qualification antigen specific is essential for distinguishing vaccination from non-specific immune modulation. And this is the most successful application of immunology and also most cost efficient measure in medicine. Say one or two doses of vaccine can give us lifelong protection against very dreaded diseases. So it's very cost efficient measure. So before I proceed further, I would like to clarify what is infection and disease. We commonly interchange these terms, infection and disease. We say like, I have an infection, but these terms, they are different. Infection and disease are different. Infection is interaction between pathogen and host that results in a limited harmless host response that eventually, but not necessarily, cause pathologic disease. So infection can lead to disease, but not necessarily. But infection means that pathogen has entered the human body and there is interaction between the pathogen and host, and there is limited harmless host immune response. But what is disease? Disease is sign of damage to host cells and tissues. So disease, we say that I have tuberculosis disease when we have symptoms of TB disease. But like in case of tuberculosis, say 1/3 of the world population is infected with Mycobacterium tuberculosis, but we don't have disease. Although we are infected, that means pathogen is there. It is inducing limited immune response, or it is in a dynamic state, in a stable state. So we are infected. But a person is having disease, tuberculosis disease, only when they have the symptoms. There is damage to host cells and tissues. So this damage could be caused directly by the microbe or the pathogen, or by the host immune system. And sometimes the pathogen doesn't cause any harmful effect, but the host immune response, which is evoked in response to that pathogen, that causes damage to the tissues. So like in case of Mycobacterium tuberculosis, most of the damage is caused by the host immune system only. This tuberculosis, it remains a global threat with 2 billion people infected, and annually there are about 2 million deaths. And this combination of AIDS and tuberculosis, this is a dangerous liaison. And although control measures are there, both chemotherapy and vaccination is there. Chemotherapy is there. It is effective against lung pulmonary tuberculosis, but it has to be taken for a long period of time, say minimum of 6 to 8 months time, minimal. And but in other extra pulmonary cases, it has to be taken up to 18 months of time. So because of this long duration of chemotherapy, there is poor compliance. What happens when the patients start feeling little better, after 2 to 3 months, they stop taking chemotherapy, stop taking those drugs, and which leads to increase in the incidence of MDR-TB. The current vaccine, BCG is the current vaccine which is available. And we all have been vaccinated with this BCG vaccine. This is very effective against severe form of childhood tuberculosis. It prevents severe form of this tuberculosis childhood, but is ineffective against adult pulmonary TB. So that's why we are seeing so many cases of tuberculosis around us, because its protective efficacy wanes in adolescents. And if we give booster vaccine to BCG, booster of BCG only, it doesn't give higher protection, and in some cases even aggravated pro-inflammatory response is there, damage to the lung is there. So we cannot give booster vaccine of BCG, and theoretical efficacy is about 50% only. So since BCG fails to provide sufficient protection against TB, so there are continuous efforts to find a new vaccines. And under this approach, both subunit vaccine and whole bacterial vaccines, subunit vaccines and whole bacterial vaccines are being studied. Subunit vaccines both have their advantages and disadvantages. Both have their advantages and disadvantages. Under subunit vaccines, purified peptide vaccine, purified protein antigens or DNA vaccines are there. And they can induce only limited amount of immune response, say CD4, CD8 type of T cells. But the whole bacterial vaccines, they can induce all these different type of immune cells. This is gamma delta T cells, CD1 restricted T cells, CD4, CD8, and they also have built-in adjuvant activity. With subunit vaccines, we need to give adjuvants along with those purified protein antigens to increase their immunogenicity. But in the whole bacterial vaccines, their immunogenicity is itself high because of whole range of antigens present inside the lipids and cell wall components. Everything is there, so which increases their immunogenicity. So tuberculosis, it is mainly a disease of the lung, and it is transmitted by aerogenic route. So inhaled bacteria, they are taken up by the alveolar macrophages, which are the main effector cells. But MTB, somehow it has strategies to survive inside the macrophages, which otherwise should be able to eliminate it quickly like any other pathogen. So that's why this disease, still a effective vaccine is not available. So as I said, that other mycobacterial strains which share antigens with MTB, they are being studied. So one such strain is Mycobacterium indica sprani, or we call it as MIP abbreviation. This is an atypical saprophytic mycobacterium, and this was discovered in late 1970s by the founder director of NII only. And out of a panel of 16 strains of atypical mycobacteria, this was selected to as it induced highest cell-mediated immune response against M. leprae. At that time, leprosy disease was quite prevalent in 70s, and a vaccine against leprosy was desired. So later on in 1980s, its immunotherapeutic activity was evaluated in phase-wise clinical trial in multibacillary leprosy patients. 30,000 household contacts of leprosy patients, they were given this vaccine. These 29,000 people, they were spread over 272 villages in Kanpur. And retrospective analysis, that area has both leprosy as well as TB. This is endemic to both diseases. A retrospective analysis after 13 years, it showed very good protective efficacy against tuberculosis also. In the control group, the prevalence of tuberculosis was 1.18, but in the group which was given this vaccine, this percentage prevalence reduced to 0.72%. And again, the subgroup of those people which already had BCG in the childhood, the degree of protection was even higher. This percentage prevalence reduced to 0.53%. So this was very interesting observation. And after that, our group started systematic study with this Mycobacterium indica sprani to evaluate its protective efficacy against tuberculosis. We started our work in around 2004-2005. Since this was considered as non-pathogenic, we studied its clearance kinetics, that whether it gets cleared from the host body, and it was observed that yes, in 4 week time, it was not present in any of the organ, lungs, spleen or lymph node. It completely gets cleared. This is a very good quality, very interesting quality of any vaccine candidate, that it can survive for a limited period inside the host body so that it can evoke a sufficient number of memory cells. 4 week time is a very good time for a good immunogenic vaccine. And if it gets automatically cleared from the host body, so chances of adverse reactions are very minimal. And we checked its reaction in all the organs. There was no untoward reaction in any of the organ. Then we proceeded to evaluate its protective efficacy, both live form as well as killed form in guinea pig model of tuberculosis. Since guinea pig is a very susceptible model of tuberculosis. So different forms of this MIP, live as well as kept, by subcutaneous route or by aerosol route, and in comparison to the BCG, which is the current vaccine and control group, its protective efficacy was evaluated in terms of lung bacterial load. After 4 weeks after infection, it was observed that live MIP through aerosol route, it gave highest protection. Colony forming units or the bacterial load was minimal. So why aerosol route gave higher protection was because lung is mainly the disease of the, this TB is mainly the disease of lung. So aerosol route of immunization is supposed to give immediate local lung response along with the systemic immune response. So in because of immediate local lung immune response, it gave higher response as compared to the immune group where subcutaneous vaccine was given. And live vaccine gave higher response as compared to the killed vaccine. Then we checked the long-term protection, that which is the ultimate goal of any vaccine. When the gap between the immunization and infection was increased, even then we got higher response with this in this group as compared to the BCG group. This group as compared to the BCG, there was further 1 log reduction in the bacterial load. Then after evaluating its, I am only giving glimpses of this work because idea is not to give detailed study, just to give a overview of work which is going on. So after simultaneously, we evaluated the immunotherapeutic activity of this vaccine. The previous studies, previous slides, they showed the immunoprotective activity or immunoprophylactic activity of vaccine. Since prolonged chemotherapy of TB results in poor compliance and drug resistance, so including immunotherapy along with this ATT or anti-tuberculosis therapy, this could be a beneficial strategy. And we evaluated this immunotherapeutic activity also in guinea pig model. So we, two models were used. In one, 30-day therapy was given or 60-day therapy. And this vaccine was given at 15 days interval in already infected guinea pigs. And what we observed that as compared to the only drug group, the group which was given drug along with this immunotherapy, there was further reduction in the bacterial load. And this was very interesting observation, and especially potentially very useful in eradicating the persistent bacteria. Because, and then we also checked the lung pathology, and it was observed that similar to the bacterial load, the gross pathology, both macroscopic pathology as well as histopathology, showed that significantly reduced pathology was there in the drug plus immunotherapy group as compared to the group which was given only drugs. Then simultaneously, since currently, as I said, that the BCG gives protection against childhood tuberculosis in children, so it is very difficult to totally eliminate BCG and substitute it with the other vaccine, because for that we need long-term clinical trial. So it is not practical. practical to replace the BCG. So it is more logical to give a booster vaccine, some other booster vaccine for protection against adult tuberculosis till the time a radically effective vaccine is available. And also this double-blind Kanpur trial, I showed that in the subgroup who had received BCG in their childhood, higher protection of MIP was observed. So we evaluated systematically that whether BCG, this MIP as a booster vaccine to BCG, can it boost the BCG protective immune response? Can it give higher immune protective immune response? So we immunized 4 groups of guinea pigs, 1 group with BCG, 1 group with BCG and booster of MIP was given by subcutaneous route. In the other group, MIP booster was given by aerosol route, and this was the control group. And we observed that this BCG primed and MIP boosted group, further 1 log reduction in the bacteria was there as compared to the only BCG immunized group. So this was very encouraging result. And this also showed in the macroscopic lesions. As you can see, this is the control group, which is no vaccine is given. This is BCG immunized group, and this is BCG immunized plus given MIP booster. We can clearly see that higher number of nodules are present in the control group and more hemorrhagic spots are there. But in the group which were given MIP booster, significantly less pathology was there. And even the alveolar tissue, healthy alveolar tissue was significantly, percentage of that tissue was significantly higher as compared to the control and the BCG group. And then we analyzed the immune response in the infected lungs after infection. So it was observed that the protective cytokines, IL-12, IL-2, interferon gamma, IL-17, its percentage was, these expression of these genes was significantly high as compared to the other groups. So it was inducing a protective immune response. And simultaneously, we conducted a clinical trial. This trial was conducted by DBT. This was a multicentric double-blind placebo-controlled trial, and our group was part of that. And this vaccine was given as an immunotherapeutic vaccine along with chemotherapeutic drugs in category 2 TB patients, which are very difficult to treat. In those patients it was given, and it was observed that significantly higher number of patients in the MIP group, they achieved sputum culture conversion. Here I would explain what is sputum culture conversion. These tuberculosis patients, their sputum is MTB positive. This is the main diagnostic test of these patients. And at 4 weeks after giving this vaccine, along with the chemotherapeutic drugs, so higher number of patients, their sputum was converted to negative state. 3 times they were tested. And this is very important observation. It has implication in spread of the tuberculosis disease, because live bacteria, they spread through aerogenic route. If the patient has sputum positive, that is live MTB is there in there, so through the aerosol, when the patient talks or patient coughs, it spreads to other healthy individuals. But if their sputum converts into negative state, so spreadability of the disease decreases. So it has very important implication, and also difficult to treat patients. Those having a very high bacterial load, having bilateral cavities or resistant to 2 or 3 drugs, they were cured in the group which was given MIP immunotherapy along with drugs as compared to the placebo group. Excuse me, so are you able to listen? No? Are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Recently, a phase 3 randomized double-blind placebo-controlled study by ITRC and ICMR has started to evaluate its efficacy and safety in household contacts of pulmonary TB patients. The previous clinical trial, which concluded, that was immunotherapeutic trial. This is immunoprophylactic trial to study its protective efficacy in those household contacts which are more susceptible to getting tuberculosis. So this trial is underway and it's undergoing. The results are not yet out, and it is being compared with a vaccine by this VPM-1002 is a vaccine developed by Stephen Kaufman, who is a sort of very, very eminent scientist, and that is recombinant BCG vaccine, VPM-1002. So simultaneously, we are evaluating protective efficacy of MIP with the recombinant BCG vaccine. So here I would like to mention that MIP has major advantage for the practical implementation of this vaccine to masses. Since this is not a recombinant vaccine, this is not a purified protein or peptide, so it is not having any storage problem. It is very sturdy thing, very easy to produce, very cost effective vaccine. Purified proteins and peptides, they are difficult to produce, very expensive thing, and then giving it to the rural area, that is also very difficult because cold chain has to be maintained for those. So this is also licensed to an Indian pharmaceutical company, and who is conducting further clinical trial also. So now I switch gear and I will briefly tell about the cancer immunotherapy. So what is cancer? Cancer is a disease in which a group of cells display uncontrolled growth, invasion and metastasis. So cancer is different from benign tumor or benign growth because of its invasiveness and metastasis. In metastasis is that from original start or original point, it can spread to distant organs also. So that is very dangerous. So currently surgery, chemotherapy and radiotherapy, these are the main three treatment strategies which are given to patients. Surgery, of course, it can be done only in those patients where it can be removed, where there is solid mass, where the organ can be removed or the tumor can be extracted. Radiotherapy is more localized treatment. Chemotherapy is systemic. It gives systemic response. And in most of the patients, chemotherapy is given. Although it has shown effectiveness, but it has drawbacks because it has toxicity towards normal tissue. It fails due to its plastic nature of cancer cells, as well as toxicity to other normal cells. These cytotoxic drugs, they put selection pressure on cancer cells and the emergent population becomes resistant. So what is desired is targeted multidimensional therapy. And it is now known, and there is strong evidence that the cancer immunosurveillance process is there in the host. In a healthy host, tumorogenic mutations, they take place continuously, but our immune system is capable of removing those abnormal or aberrant cells. So that's why we all of us don't have cancer. And this knowledge existed long before the modern period, with multiple reports of tumor disappearing spontaneously or after the infectious episode. That is, even in the patients who were having tumor, if simultaneously some serious infection take place in those patients, and in some of them, tumor disappeared. That observation was there. And also another observation is that immunosuppressed patients, they have higher risk of cancer. So these observation, they provide evidence that yes, immune system can play a role in removing the cancer. But then why do we have cancer? Because the immune system is often not able to mount an effective response. Why it is not able to mount an effective response is because of the negative regulatory mechanisms by growing cancer. These growing cancer cells, they secrete some factors and they suppress the surrounding immune cells. So there is constant tussle between the host and the cancer. So this is a pictorial depiction how immune response can control the multiplication of cancer. This I think in my laptop, actually, this cursor is not working. These are normal cells. These are tumor cells. Tumor cells, one of the strategy tumor cells uses that the tumor specific antigen, which can be recognized by the antigen presenting cells or by the immune cells, they hide their tumor specific antigen. So those are not clearly visible. But when these tumor cells, they die by one way or the other, then these tumor specific antigens, they become visible. And they can be recognized by these professional antigen presenting cells. And professional antigen presenting cells, they process it and they present this peptide to both CD8 T cells and CD4 T cells. CD8 T cells have the direct cytotoxicity towards the tumors, and they can directly kill by secreting the granzyme and perforin. They can directly kill. And these CD4 T cells, they can help, they can secrete cytokines, pro-inflammatory cytokines, they can also play a role. But and also these CD4 T cells, they activate B cells. B cells, activated B cells, they recognize the tumor antigen and then can produce tumor-specific antibodies. These antibodies then in turn can neutralize or they can kill the target tumor cells. So this is the theoretical, or actually this type how immune system works against cancer, this is shown pictorially. But what happens in real life situation is that growing cancers, they actively suppress the immune response. How do they suppress the immune responses? That they secrete IL-10 and TGF-beta. These are the cytokines IL-10, TGF-beta, which have immunosuppressive role. They convert normal active effector CD4 positive T cells to regulatory T cells. Regulatory T cells, they suppress the immune response. They are called regulatory T cells because they are anti-inflammatory T cells. And they causes CDT, these TGF-beta cytokine, it causes T cell exhaustion, T cell inhibition. And also these tumor cells, they express FAS ligand. And then FAS ligand interaction on with T cells interaction with tumor cell, that leads to the apoptosis or death of the effector T cells. So in a way, tumor cells, they convert the kill the effector T cells or suppress the T cells, or they convert them in from effector to the regulatory T cells. They exhaust the T cells, and also they suppress the macrophages in their surrounding. M1 type macrophages, which are considered active, they are converted to M2 type macrophages. So these are few of the strategies which tumor cells employ to suppress the immune cells. So what is required is immunotherapy. Now again, what is immunotherapy? Immunotherapy is also called biologic therapy, which boosts the body's natural defenses to fight cancer. In a way, it boosts the natural immune cells. They act through one of the several mechanisms. By stimulating the anti-tumor immunity, that is overturning the immunosuppressive tumor environment to stimulatory state by using the potent adjuvant, or by increasing the number of effector cells, or by producing cytokines and lymphokines, pro-inflammatory cytokines, like Th1 type of immune responsive protective against cancer. So it in immunotherapy can induce Th1 or Th17 type of response. By altering the tumor microenvironment to increase their immunogenicity and make them more susceptible to immunologic defenses. So it involves host immune system using a variety of approaches, cancer vaccines, monoclonal antibodies, infusion of activated T cells or dendritic cells. These are autologous dendritic cells or autologous T cells, and non-specific immunotherapies or checkpoint inhibitors. I will talk about only non-specific immunotherapy, which is bacterial immunostimulant. These induces non-specific inflammatory response at tumor site and may help to reject the tumor. So now our group, it is evaluating immunotherapeutic potential of MIP and the underlying mechanism in mouse tumor model, and also simultaneously clinical trials have been conducted. So why we have evaluated MIP in the tumor model? Because MIP induces TH1 type of immune response. And this same TH1 type of immune response is also protective against tumor. So that was the background why we evaluated in tumor model. But now we are seeing of late, although I am not showing those results, it has some specific response, directly kills the tumor cells also. Those studies we are doing. But here I will discuss only how it is inducing TH1 type of immune response and reduce the tumor. So in the mouse model of tumor, we used melanoma model, which is very aggressive tumor. And we gave MIP injection, weekly injection of MIP near the site of the tumor. And it was observed, this is the group 2, which was given MIP immunotherapy. And this is the control group, which was not given any therapy. So and this graph shows tumor growth. This is tumor growth with time, tumor volume. And as we can see, there is significant reduction in the tumor volume, as well as there is delayed tumor growth in the group which MIP immunotherapy was given. And when we evaluated tumor microenvironment, it was observed that higher infiltration of immune cells was there in the group which was MIP treated as compared to the control. Like there's 10.31% cells here, it is just double. And it increased the number of both CD4, CD8, NK cells, and these dendritic cells and macrophages, they were in activated state in the tumor microenvironment of the group which was given MIP. So, and also another interesting observation was that the regulatory T cells, which suppress the immune response, their percentage, in my laptop, actually, this cursor is not working. In the tumor mass, the percentage of regulatory T cells, it was just half as compared to the control group. So it decreased the percentage of regulatory T cells. So this is very interesting observation. But in real life situation, as we know, this was the mouse model, and we started immunotherapy from the second, third day itself. But in real life situation, when the patient comes to the clinic, they already have a well-grown tumor. In those situations, immunotherapy can rarely work, or immunotherapies could be rarely sufficient to reduce the tumor volume. So it has to be given along with the chemotherapy. And chemotherapy can potentiate the immunotherapy via multiple pathways. It is reported thing because chemotherapy can reduce the tumor burden. And by reduction in the tumor burden, so immunotherapy can act on the remaining tumor cells. And by reducing the tumor burden, and also it will reduce the T regulatory cells, and it makes this... I think this much is enough for the students at this stage, that chemotherapy can potentiate the immunotherapy through multiple pathways. So what we did, in one group, we gave, this is cyclophosphamide. In one group, this is the control group, where no therapy was given. This is the drug group, cyclophosphamide. This is the drug plus MIP group. As we can see, and these stars show that the mice died at this time point. The group which was given MIP immunotherapy along with the chemotherapy, there was significant reduction in the tumor volume, and only 4 mice out of 8, they developed tumor, and in 2, there was very minimal tumor. This is tumor growth curve. So I am just giving you glimpses how this system is working. And these are the pictures, just representative pictures of tumor. And also now MIP immunotherapy is approved in non-small cell lung cancer patients. This is a type of lung cancer. This trial was conducted by Cadila Laboratory. This was open label randomized controlled clinical trial and was given to very advanced stage of lung cancer patients. So now it is approved for human use in this particular category of cancer patients, along with paclitaxel and cisplatin. These are the chemotherapeutic drugs which are being given for these cancer patients. So now I would like to start the questions. Is cool. full screen. चैट बॉक्स कैसे देख पाएंगे? चैट बॉक्स में देख पाएंगे। ओके ठीक है। नहीं बट आई कैन एस्केप इन दैट अभी क्वेश्चंस नहीं विजिबल सो स्टूडेंट्स आर यू रेडी टू गिव आंसर टू दीज क्वेश्चंस इन द चैट बॉक्स दो स्टूडेंट्स हु विल गिव हायर नंबर ऑफ आंसर्स करेक्ट आंसर्स जस्ट वन लाइन आंसर और टू थ्री वर्ड्स आंसर इज इनफ दे विल गेट ए सर्टिफिकेट ऑफ एप्रिशिएशन Can you raise your hands? Are you ready? And then you will have to mark answer to question one or question two. Hello.
Excuse me.
I am asking first question, why do live vaccines generally give higher protection as compared to killed vaccine? I explained it and by common sense also students can answer. Just two, three word answer is also enough. They can write in the chat box. Can you compare the immunogenicity In terms of immunogenicity, which one is better, live or killed? Nee, that is known that live vaccine give higher response. This is not the right answer. Why live vaccines give higher response as compared to killed? Some of you have just written live vaccine. That is known fact, but why? Question is why? You have written that it will replicate. Replication, it's right. So replication, what will the impact of this replication?
Ma'am, immune response will be developed.
Yes, higher immune response. Kill vaccine also induces immune response. But the higher immune response, higher immunogenicity is due to with live vaccines because they persist in the host body for some time, which is enough, that duration is enough to generate memory T cells, memory immune response. Yes. Vaccines work on the principle of generation of memory response, memory immune response. So now next question is why booster vaccine to BCG is required? Question number one is over. why booster vaccine to BCG is required? Is there some characteristic of BCG that it is good? That's why we are not removing BCG. I mentioned it during my talk.
To provide lifetime immunity.
Lifetime immunity. But what is the main advantage of BCG? And write in the chat box also, because we are noting down your name. Verbal answer also, they can just tell their name. Just tell your name and then. I mentioned that there is some quality of BCG. That's why we can't remove BCG vaccine as such, and we need to give some booster.
Someone has said crucial part, has said protects against tuberculosis.
No, no. Other than tuberculosis, no. That is not the idea.
And there is one more answer. Says BCG vaccine may increase the ability of the immune system to fight off.
Ma'am, it is given in the in bird to prevent the infection.
Infection? So we all are infected. It will prevent the disease.
Yes, ma'am.
It is long lasting and creates strong immunity. That is right. That is right. But there is some, I told that there is some quality of BCG. Childhood tuberculosis, do you remember that it is very protective against childhood tuberculosis? But its protective efficacy wanes in adolescence. That is the right answer, because it gives protection against childhood tuberculosis. So we immediately can't replace the BCG vaccine. So what is required is, if we give some booster, so it will give protection against adult tuberculosis also. Note down the names.
Sithiman never has said protection from TB.
Yes, it will give protection from, I'm talking. Third question is, why early sputum conversion in TB is important? I told that if the patient's sputum converts from positive to negative, this is very important observation. So why early sputum conversion is important? Now answer third question. I told that BIP vaccine, it converts the sputum positive patients to sputum negative. Early conversion is there, which is very important. Even by guess also you can. Nobody has given answer to third question. Even the wild guess can also help. No. Sputum conversion, I am saying that if some medicine or some vaccine can convert TB patients whose sputum is positive for Mycobacterium tuberculosis to MTB negative, that is, their sputum is no longer infectious, how this will help? One person, this Raj Shri Bora, reduce the transmission. Very, yes, good. Very good. Very good. It result treatment delay. No. And Gobinda Saik, it will reduce the transmission. Why it will reduce the transmission? Because it transmits through aerogenic route only. Mriganika Das, you know down the name. Mayur Bora. Okay, now to everybody will write, since I have given the answer.
Actually, that we can note down by the chat box.
Rashiri, do you want to ask something?
Open.
Okay. Our next question. Next question is, immune system can act against tumor, then why do we have cancer? When it is known that immune system can act against tumor, then why do we have cancer? I showed a pictorial representation that tumor does something. Just two word answer or give answer to my next question, otherwise nobody will get the certificate of appreciation.
Ask again, please.
Question is, immune system can act against tumor. This is well established that immune system can kill the tumor cells. But then why do we have cancer? We all have immune system.
Cell divide continuously.
Cell divide continuously, it's okay. But tumor cells do something to the immune cells. I showed a pictorial representation. DNA changes, that causes tumor. But why immune system is not able to kill those cancer cells? Immune system should recognize those tumor specific antigen over the tumor cells, because those are abnormal cells.
Yes,
right answer. Siddhiman, your cancer can weaken our immune system. Only Siddhiman Newer has given the right answer. Now, Mayur Bora. Okay, I'll go to the next question. I'm not asking question number 5, question number 6. What is the difference between immunoprophylactic and immunotherapeutic vaccine? I mentioned these terms, immunoprophylactic vaccine, immunotherapeutic vaccine, which is given before infection and which is given after infection. These are two vaccines which are given at different stages of, one is given before infection, one is given after infection. Immunoprophylactic and immunotherapeutic vaccine. Whosoever will give right answer first. Immunoprophy before and immunotherapeutic. What about immunotherapy after?
Yes.
Very good. Rohit Gupta. Anybody else? अब तो वही करेंगे चलो ठीक है नोट करो राशि बोरा एंड मयूर दो सो आई नो मूव टू नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन बाय मिप वैक्सीन बाय एरोसोल रूट गेव हायर प्रोटेक्शन व्हेन द वैक्सीन वाज गिवन बाय एरोसोल रूट इंस्टेड ऑफ सबकुटेनियस रूट इट गेव हायर प्रोटेक्शन डिफरेंट रूट ऑफ वैक्सीनेशन gave different level of protection in tuberculosis. I am asking about MIP vaccine in the context of tuberculosis vaccine. Why it gave higher protection? Quickly. Even guess can work. Aerosol route, that means that vaccine was given by inhalation, not by injection. Then with that vaccine gave higher protection in tuberculosis. Can anybody tell tuberculosis, which organ it affects most? Tuberculosis is mainly disease of the lung. No, wrong answer. Booster to infection occurs in lung. Okay, but infection occurs in lungs. Then why aerosol route is giving higher protection? Somebody should tell. If the vaccine is reaching to the target organ where the bacteria is there, so what is expected? Enhanced immune response. Yes, Rohit Gupta. Rohit Gupta first. Okay. Thank you very much. I hope I could give glimpse or the overview of the work which is going on in a research institute in our group, Enhanced Immune Response.
Thank you, madam. This is indeed an informative talk.
Thank you. Can we leave the meeting?
Now, our colleague, Dr. Bipul Shaikia, Associate Professor, Department of Botany, will offer a vote of thanks for the program.
Good afternoon, everybody.
I would request you to please take a screenshot of the meeting where like all the participants, they have switched on their camera, if they can, and then please take the screenshot. All of you, please switch on your camera if you can.
So have you taken the screenshot?
Is it taken?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay.
I have taken screenshot.
Okay.
It is taken.
Please start. So we are coming to the last part of today's online lecture series. So this topic today we discussed by our resource person is very interesting, very fruitful. And it is arranged in such a way that our students also cooperated and easily understand what is vaccine, types of vaccines, cancers, tuberculosis, and some new terms known by our students and about the cancers. So this topic highlighted about the about the types of vaccines and even some cancers and the response into different tumors and immunity of the human body. So all these long slides and long time, our respected Sangeeta Bhaskar Madam give a detail about these topics of vaccines and tumors and cancers. So at first, I offer my sincere thanks to Madam for his valuable talk to the teachers, to the students, and the guest today's presence in the webinar. And also, I offer my sincere thanks to our principal sirs who inaugurate the meetings and attend the meetings from the start to end. And so I also offer my sincere thanks to our colleagues who present in the webinar from the start to end. And then lastly, I offer my sincere thanks to the teachers, participants, guests, and my dear students who attending the online lecture series and also participate in the question answers program. So I again offer my sincere thanks to the madam who gives a valuable talk to us today, and hope madam will give more lectures in future in cooperation with the DVT and our Sodhya College. So with these few words, I conclude my vote of thanks. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bipul Sekia. And it's my privilege, it's my pleasure to give this talk and interact with the students. And the idea was to give a glimpse how research work is carried out in a research institute, where both basic science as well as applied science research is being conducted. Simultaneously, we are doing clinical trials, and also we are working in the mouse model. So I think students must have got an idea. The basically aim was to give an idea.
Yes, yes. So well, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I offer sincere thanks to Jyoti Singh for her continuous relation with us to organize this webinar.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Please do not leave.
No, I didn't leave you.
Okay.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Welcome.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.